I seek Allah's protection from the rejected shaitan. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. In all things I say, I am faithful to what Muhammad and his purified family have spoken. That which they have concealed and that which they have revealed. In what has reached me of them and in that which is not. Praised be Allah, the Lord of the worlds. And may his blessings and peace be upon the master of all creation, our master, Muhammad, and his purified progeny. Peace be upon them. And may his damnations be upon their killers and their enemies till the hereafter. We have reached in the topic in which we described what Al-Mujaddid al-Thani has spoken about and commented on in his Fiqh Encyclopedia in narrations and reports of the Takfir of the so-called Sunnis. And we said this takfir specifically with those narrations was referring to the Battery sect. It is that narration that As-Saduq in his I'tiqadat book of Imam As-Sadiq, peace be upon him, who said those who doubt the disbelief of our enemies and those who are unjust to us, he is a disbeliever, a kafir. Mujaddid al-Thani continues on discussing the rest of these narrations, and he said of Furat, of his narration, of his chain of narration leading to Imam Sadiq, peace be upon him, said when this narration was revealed, well, this verse was revealed, and those who are people of the scriptures shall believe in it. The Messenger of Allah said, no one shall deny what Isa ibn Maryam, peace be upon him, has revealed, because those who deny are disbelievers, kafir. So is with Abi Talib, and the Messenger of Allah then is also a disbeliever. It is similar. So in a sense, so if you were to reject what the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, has said of Ali, it is similar to rejecting what Allah has said to Isa or about Isa ibn Maryam. There you are a disbeliever, and here and you are also a disbeliever. And of Safwan al-Jamal, of Abi Abdullah, peace be upon him, who said, when Wilaya was declared for Ali, peace be upon him, one man among the people stood up and said, this messenger has now established for this man a tie which cannot be untied except by a disbeliever. Who is this man who stood up from among the people and said, made this statement? And by the way, it was one of the people who heard this statement was Umar, may Allah curse him. Till he said, the narration continues on and says that the Messenger of Allah responded, this is Gabriel. Gabriel in the shape of a man, in the appearance of a man. And maybe it was the first time that Umar and his ilk has seen Gabriel in that that way. Because he sometimes would reveal himself in the form of a man. This messenger, blessings, peace be upon him and his pure family, has established or tied something for this man, and to untie it is a disbeliever. So the vow of Ghadir, if it was broken, then you are a disbeliever. And there's no doubt that Abu Bakr and Umar and those who joined them were the first to break those vows. The vow or the tie of Ghadir. They are disbelievers as the Messenger of Allah himself has declared. And of Yahya ibn al-Qasim, of Ja'far ibn Muhammad, peace be upon them. Of his fathers, peace be upon them. Of the Messenger of Allah, blessings and peace be upon him and his pure family, who said, the Imams after me are 12. The first is Ali bin Abi Talib. The last is the awaited Imam, till he said, those who accept them are believers, and those who reject them are disbelievers. And the narration is very clear. Does not require description. And of Hussain ibn Ali, peace be upon him, of the Messenger of Allah, blessings and peace be upon him and his pure family, in a narration in which he said, those who claim to love the Messenger of Allah and to not love his successor are liars. And those who claim they know the Messenger of Allah and they don't know his successor are also disbelievers. And we have detailed this narration previously. And in the narration of Kabuli, of Hussain ibn Ali, peace be upon them, and those who hate us, reject us, or reject a single one of us, has disbelieved in Allah and His signs. And this narration we've also mentioned, but you've known, it was by Ali ibn al-Hussain, peace be upon him. Not Hussain ibn Ali, peace be upon him. It could be that the narrator has mistakenly written Hussain ibn Ali instead of Ali ibn Hussain, peace be upon him. And Muhammad ibn Islam of Abi Ja'far, peace be upon him, who said, I said to him, have you seen those? Or what do you see of those who have rejected one of you? I said, those who reject an imam and dissociated of his religion and him, he's an apostate and he's a disbeliever and has apostated. And narration has a continuation, of course. And of course, this narration alone is not enough to use to make a rule declaring the so-called Sunnis as disbelievers. Because he said, if those who disbelieved, rejected one of the Imams and dissociated. Some of the opposers say, I do not dissociate from Ja'far ibn Muhammad. I don't accept him as an Imam. The Imam that you say means that he must be obeyed in all things. I don't believe that. But I do believe he's one of the Imams of the Islamic faith. And I do not dissociate from him and his religion. And there is narration by Al-Baqir, peace be upon him, says, those who reject an imam and dissociate from his religion and him, It's as if these are all conditions which have been placed, which without, it is not correct to say that an opposer is a kafir. That's why I say this narration alone isn't to use as a source for a rule stating that the opposer is a disbeliever. And Ahmed Muhammad ibn Mutahhar, who said, some of our companions have written to Abi Muhammad, peace be upon him, Imam al-Askari, peace be upon him. Some of our companions have written to Imam al-Askari, peace be upon him, asking about those who stood or waited or rejected any imams after Imam al-Kadhim, peace be upon him. So those who were known as the waqifah, which means those who stood or refused any imam after Imam al-Kadhim, peace be upon him. And this letter was sent to Imam al-Askari, peace be upon him, the 11th imam, asking him, those who stopped at Imam al-Kadhim, peace be upon him, and rejected the imams after, what is the consequence? He said, don't ask Allah's mercy for your uncle and their person, and as he said, some of the companions written, there are some who have written, people who have written, or the person who has written, he hasn't written that was my uncle who rejected the imams after Imam al-Kadhim, but the imam knows what's in their hearts. So he responded, he said, do not ask Allah's mercy for your uncle, the Waqifi follower, and dissociate to Allah from him. There is no room here to what we call is keeping or being kind to your kin, because in here, even if they are kin or your close relatives, it's in direct conflict with obeying Allah. Because obedience to Allah is the number one proper priority, and it's the very first and the most important connection. And it seems like the uncle of this person who asked the question was one of the heads of this Waqifi sect and those who have promoted it. Because what we understand from the history of the Imams, peace upon him, that they were strict with the rulings against the heads of this disbelief or deviancy. But the followers and those who were misled, they would have aimed to guide them. And one of the things to means to guide people is to communicate and to show mercy. But the heads of disbelief, no. It must be that they are treated harshly and treated accordingly. And that's why he said, do not ask Allah's blessings upon, Allah's mercy upon your uncle, and say and declare that you dissociate to Allah from him. Allah forbid, but sometimes you must say, I dissociate from my own father, just like Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr has done, may Allah bless his soul. He went to the commander of the faithful, peace be upon him, and he said, extend your hand to pay my allegiance to you. And the imam said, did you not do that before? He said, yes, I have. However, I want to give my allegiance to you, declaring my dissociation from my father. Rafidi vow. And the first time, his vow, his allegiance was obedience to the Imam. Now it's rejection, rejecting the enemies of Imam, peace be upon him. And the Imam extended his hand, and he, Abu Bakr said, I testify that you're an Imam that must be obeyed, and that my father is in hellfire. And the allegiance was made. And he became one of the first and the finest of companions of the Imams, peace be upon him. So the Imam, peace be upon him, responded, Imam al-Askari, those who stopped believing the Imams after Imam al-Kadhim, he said, peace be upon him, he said, dissociate to Allah from him. Don't obey them or adhere to them. And don't even visit their ill. And don't go in their funerals. And don't pray. Don't pray upon those who passed away from them. And this might seem to those who are not intellectual, strange, because there is a known narration, and the parties, misled parties, would do that, such as the misled regime of Iran, saying that the Imams would tell us always to visit the opposers, see their ill, and testify for them or against them. And yes, we have a narration for this. And it's a narration that must be followed. And we also ask that, and we say, if you have opposers or your neighbors, communicate with this person. If he's ill, go see them, visit them. Take something with you, flowers or sweets, anything that would make this person feel better. Someone from their family passes away, also give your condolences to them, visit them and join their funerals. So how is it possible that the Imam, peace be upon him, here is saying, do not. Don't visit their ill. Don't join their funerals. And don't even pray upon the coffins or the bodies of those who passed from them. It is said, or could be said, that these people could be closer to us because the Waqifi sect, they are with us until seven Imams. The opposers don't believe in any Imam. They're not even within the Shi'i circle, so to speak. So is it not more appropriate that that we would communicate with them, or be kind to them? Why did the Imams, peace be upon them, have these two different rules? That the majority of the opposers who obey Abu Bakr and Umar and don't believe in Imam at all, and those waqif who dissociate from Abu Bakr and Umar, by the way, and they also agree with us until seven Imams. So that's what they are with us. And this is what would, something we would describe further, and Mujaddid Thani also actually paid attention to that, and he mentioned it. See, brothers, that we will, of course, detail this, but those who are from within, then are deviated, are not those from those who were originally from outside, and they were originally from outside, originally deviant. These people are treated differently, viewed differently. This is what describes why the Imams, peace be upon them, are very strict with their directions or rules for those who are from within, and then they became deviant or betrayed. They were far more strict with these people, much more harsh, if we could describe it as such. Much more stern. This is also describes why apostation, some people might say, that person disbelieves in Allah, but he has not entered faith. But there is a person who became a Muslim and then apostated, disbelieved in Islam. Why are the rules against this person are much more stern? The person who is a disbeliever, his blood isn't, you know, he's not treated so sternly, because this person was from within. He was a Muslim and then disbelieved. Not like those who from outside, who have not known, who do not have the means to become Muslim. It's not the same as judging that person from outside, the same as judging the person from inside, the person who has been a Muslim. So it cannot be excused. And also, the deviation from within is 1,000 times worse from any deviation from outside. Any deviation from outside doesn't affect those from within, because those within, from the inside, so to speak, would know that this person is a foreigner from outside, does not agree with them from the start. But those who are within you, part of you, and they have deviated, their statements will affect those who are feeble-minded or simple, or those who are ignorant. Those might be confused, and they would be lost and mistaken, and would not know who's right and who's wrong. And they start saying to each other, he's one of us. He speaks like us. His approach is similar to us. He agrees with our beliefs, though he might have some differences. But overall, this person was one of the students of the Imam. Waqif people were what? One of the followers of the students of the Imams. They were even the ones that depended on them. They were the narrators. They were from within. So their influence, their deviation, the consequences of it is much worse than someone like Abu Hanifa. Have you seen that Abu Hanifa influenced any of the Shia? No. However, Ali ibn Hamza al-Bata'ani, for example, may Allah curse him, one of the heads of the Waqifa sect, he had huge impact on the Shia followers. And he took with him many Shia people who rejected the Imam of Amr Rida, peace be upon him. Why? Because he's from within the same circle. That's why he has his connections, and because he has his connections, and at one point he was trustworthy, dependable. So that is why the judgment, the ruling is different. Even when it comes to treatment, how we treat these people. So if we are allowed to go see a Bakri ill person, it does not mean that we can go and visit a Bakri ill person. Because a Bakri person is much more dangerous. And me going to visit him, or me communicating with him, it might be seen in the eyes of the general public as an admission from me that he's one of us. Otherwise, I would not have visited him, seen him, or mentioned him in such a way. This is important to notice. For example, me, personally, if I went to see a so-called Sunni person, even he was one of their sheikhs, one of their preachers, for example, who has no impact. Many of their preachers don't have that much of an impact. And maybe I wish to bring him closer it's for whatever benefit I go and visit him when he's ill. And I've also presented him with a flower. Any believer, is there, would there be any Rafidi believer who knows who I am, would think that this visit means that my visit is an admission that of the legitimacy of the person I've seen. And he says that Sheikh is making this person trustworthy and we should follow, listen to him. He would know from the very start. This is a person from a different religion in a sense, and this visit was not given legitimacy to that person. However, if I were to go and visit one of the symbols of the Battery sect or their so-called sheikhs, how would this be seen by people? It would be seen differently, because that person speaks in the name of Shi'i faith. He wears my dress and my turban, and he says, I am Shi'i. I am the true Shi'i. So when I go and see him, it would be seen by people as a form of acceptance. So that is why it is what is required that I do not visit that person. Even if people might see him as closer, what we have between us, the similarities are many. For example, we pray on the turba, he does. That person visits Imam Hussain and cries upon Imam Hussain, just like us. Do you think the Battery sect in the past did not cry, weep for Imam Hussain, peace be upon him? They did so wholeheartedly. But they have a huge issue on the other side. This is what led these narrations. In one aspect, the narrations would say, visit the so-called Sunnis, communicate with them, see their ill, and join their funerals, so on and so forth, of ethical treatments and moral acts. But when it comes to waqifah, at all, they refer to them as dogs who are wet, and you do not want to be near them in case you become najis. Say that you associate Allah from them. Do not accept them. Do not see their ill. Do not accept anything from them. Do not see their ill. Do not join the funerals. Complete dissociation. Why? So that they are secluded and exiled from the Shi'i faith, and so that they die, perish, and so does their faith. Everyone knows those people are rejected and hated by Allah. And because Shia, the true Shia of that time, have adhered to that direction, a directive by the Imams, peace be upon them, the Waqifi sect has been wiped out. Is there anyone who is Waqifi now? They had some great scholars back then, narrators, and even jurists. And they had their deeds, cultural, or historical. They have all been eradicated. None of their heritage was left. Not a single Waqifi was left. Some might say, then, what about the Zaydi sect? Why do they still remain? Ismaili sect, for example. We say because they had the government that protected them, and revolutions and such. Al-Waqifa did not have a country. If they did, they would have probably stayed. In general, however, Shia people dissociated from those who claimed to be Shia while they were deviants. And this is why these sects have been eradicated and removed from our midst. In our time, unfortunately, There is negligence. Why? Battery sect is among us again. Why the so-called Irfani, the malign misled Irfani sect is still there and they are somewhat widespread. So on and so forth, sects here and there. People who claim to be Shia, even those who claim to be Rafidi. Why? Because they do what they wish and they are not exiled, they're not dissociated, they're not rejected. They are greeted, they're visited, they're communicate with others. Those who pass away from them, they are sent greeting, condolences. This causes that the cancerous cells remaining in the Shia body. What is required of us is to follow the Imam's directives. Any deviancy in our midst must be exiled and dissociated from entirely and boycotted. We must boycott these kind of people, completely boycott them. Do not accept anything from them. Do not go see their ill, join their funerals, or pray for their dead. Those who reject an imam of Allah or had another, this imamah is not from Allah. It's like saying that Allah is one of three. This is declaration of takfir. Those who reject our last is the same as those who reject our first. There is no difference between the 12 imams, peace be upon them. May Allah's blessings and peace be upon our master Muhammad and his purified progeny, peace be upon them.